Appreciate the last song sung, simply on the basis of how I can tie it in so easily with my sermon. I might pause and say before we get into the topic that certainly let us always be mindful of the songs we sing, the meaning of the words. We are speaking those songs one to another as we direct our worship to God. And as Ephesians 5:19 says, we are actually teaching one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in our heart to the Lord. When false teachers went in among the various congregations of the province known as Galatia in the Roman Empire, Paul was quick to act. And in that particular letter that he wrote to those various congregations, Galatians chapter 4 and verse 16, he asked them, and you must remember much precedes this that exposed the error that he was dealing with. He asked the churches, "Am I, Paul the apostle, therefore, in the light of everything I've written to this point, become your enemy?" The churches to which he had addressed this letter. "Am I become your enemy because I tell you the truth?" I don't know how many times that's been used as a text in sermons, how many times it's been dealt with in Bible classes. But the fact of the matter is, with a great many people, yes, if you tell me the truth, you have become my enemy. You'll remember that there were spacious false views of truth, even in that day and time. Because Jesus has said before the Roman governor Pilate, back over in chapter 18, verse 37, Pilate, therefore, in the light of what had been going on, said unto him, that is Christ, "Art thou a king then?" And Jesus answered, "Thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice." And this caused Pilate to say, "What is truth?" Well, I do not mind saying that a truth is just what a thing is. That's all it is. Truth is just exactly what a thing actually is. You will find in reading your Bible, especially the New Testament, that it deals a lot with the idea of the truth. Jesus said, "If you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." I do not mind affirming that truth is absolute and objective and humanly attainable, or else John 8:31-32 makes no sense at all. Jesus says, "In my word, you will learn the truth, and when you learn, it has the power to make you free." And the context is free from the guilt of sin. Paul had preached the gospel among the churches of Galatia, started these congregations. He knew it was the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ that made them what they were, and he wasn't about to tolerate somebody coming along teaching something else. Well, these were called Judaizing teachers because they taught that you Gentiles, you non-Jews, can be saved. But here was their plan of salvation. Hear the gospel, believe the gospel, repent of your sins, confess your faith, be immersed in water by the authority of Christ, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for the remission of your sins, and you men be circumcised. That was their plan of salvation. Now, they would say keep the law, but Paul points out, no, they're not really interested in keeping the whole law. They don't even do that. It's just the fact that if you're circumcised, they'll accept you. Under the law, when it was in effect, and Jews approached God through the law, Gentiles could come in on their own and willingly embrace the law, and the Jews would put up with them. So you see, then there were these who were so wedded to the law, not understanding the design and purpose and end of the law, that they would bring it over into Christianity and, in effect, make second-class citizens out of the Gentiles, the non-Jews. Paul made it clear in Galatians 1 that that was anathema or cursed with God to teach another gospel. In the Greek, it means a gospel of a different kind, meaning a gospel of a different kind than what Paul preached to them, because he preached to them the pure gospel of Christ. So as he gets through the letter dealing with the problems of these Judaizing teachers in the churches of Galatia, he pauses and says, am I personally become your enemy because I tell you the truth? Most cases, I hate to say it, but as I said earlier, that's the case with many people. And it happens when the people themselves are not believing or they're not living in harmony with the truth. And you point that out to them, most of them are not like Peter. The Lord rebuked him a number of times, and Paul even had to withstand him to the face because he got mixed up in some of this. But the difference in those people and a lot of folks is that they were humble and teachable and willing to see themselves as they actually were in the light of the truth and then change themselves to fit the truth. Too many people today want to change the truth to fit themselves. And you have to be honest enough with God yourself and the Word of God to say, is that the case? You're seeing it done all around you all the time. Things that when I was a young person would never be thought of as being opposed in society in general is readily set aside now. Just think about marriage itself. How many men and women, some not much more than boys and girls, are living together, but they're not married. Nobody thinks anything about it. But many years ago, that I can remember, when there weren't that many divorces, and people that divorced were sort of looked at as, what kind of people are you? But all of my lifetime, that's changed. From where it was strange, very little of it, to where it's just acceptable and common. All in one generation. Am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? I want you to turn with me to that great chapter that Paul wrote on love. And I would remind you the kind of congregation to which he addressed that letter and in that letter wrote what he did about love. The church had all sorts of problems in it. I don't know of a congregation that had as many problems and all kinds of sins going on in it like the church at Corinth. And yet in the midst of this, he writes, 1 Corinthians 13, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love or charity, I am become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, though I give my body to be burned, and have not love, it profiteth me nothing. Now I want you to look at how he describes love, beginning verse 4. I really like the word charity used by the King James translators. Because charity actually, as we think of today, is love in action. And love is worthless if it doesn't act. It's like faith. You can declare your belief in Christ all day long, but Christ will come back at you saying, well, I call you me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say. Well, you can declare your love for God all day long, but Jesus will come back at you on that one too and say, if you love me, keep my commandments. So the proof of a living, active, saving faith is obedience to the Lord. And the proof of the love of God and the love of your fellow man and the love of the church is in keeping the commandments of God. Now I want to drop down to verse 6 and read it first in 1 Corinthians 13. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Now, I want you to hold that first. People who are faithful servants of God and all that the New Testament describes, defines and describes that to be, rejoice in the truth. They don't rejoice in iniquity or that which is contrary and against the truth. So I want you to go back up to verse 4. Charity or love suffereth long, but it never suffers so long as to violate the truth. It's kind. But it never is kind the way some people define kind, to where the truth is compromised. Because love always rejoices in the truth and not in iniquity. It's not selfish. It doesn't just seek her own. But it never violates the truth concerning the individual person's responsibility to be honest with himself and to be obedient to the truth and do his best never to compromise the truth in teaching or life. It's not easily provoked. But it doesn't just put up with everything to the point of violation of the truth in the person's life. It rejoices in the truth in all these things. It thinketh no evil. Well, evil is contrary to the truth, isn't it? So the truth's going to keep me thinking the truth. And thus I'll recognize evil and reprove it and reject it and rebuke it. If you don't do that, how do you obey the commandment that Paul gave? Examine yourself to see whether you be in the truth, unless you be reprobate. It rejoiceth not in iniquity, it rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, but not to the point of violation of the truth. It believes all things, but not to the point of compromising the truth. It endures all things, but not to the point of corrupting the truth. The love principle always submits to the authority principle. And that's what Jesus meant when he says, as the American Standard Version 1901 renders it, if you love me, ye will keep my commandments. So love never fails. Never fails because it'll always submit to the truth. And he goes on then to talk about other things. So when Paul comes to these Galatians dealing with false teachers and they're being swept away, at least some of them, by the teaching of these false teachers, he says, am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? In other words, I've said some things that really poked you pretty hard because you see you're in violation of them. Well, is that the sign of a man who doesn't love you or a man who loves you? Is that the sign of an enemy or a friend? See, we got it all mixed up in this world, folks. And society says, tolerate everything. If a man wants to do this, that, or the other, whatever feels good to him, whatever looks right to him. Truth is all subjective and relative on the basis of each person. I won't judge you. And somebody will say, don't judge me. And my comeback is, you quit judging and I'll stop judging. That's the silly thing about thinking of men when it's not bridled and controlled by the Word of God rightly divided. The people who declare, don't judge me, are in the process of judging themselves and in violation of the very thing they're telling a person not to do. You cannot live your life and not come to conclusions, which means you've made a decision, which is a judgment. You decided this morning you'd come to this building. I don't know when you decided it, but you did. That's a judgment. What that means is, if I'm living contrary to God's will, if I'm immoral, if I'm involved in spiritual things not authorized by the will of Christ, don't you tell me I'm wrong. You're judging me. Well, I don't know why that they have done this, but there is a judgment in the Bible that's condemned. Nobody denies that. But they seemingly never come up with the idea that Jesus himself presented. And it's the same Jesus that says, judge not lest you be judged. Judge righteous judgment. That's an explicit statement. You see, that judge righteous judgment, since all God's commandments are righteousness, Psalms 119, verse 172, means in the light of the standard of truth that man could understand and God gave it to him to understand it, 2 Timothy 3, 16, 17, James 1, 25, then judge all things. Man was made to judge. You can abuse it, and you can misuse it, but man was made to think, compare, contrast, gather the facts, reason with it, and guess what? Come to a conclusion. And Paul actually was doing that with this rhetorical question of Galatians 4 verse 16. Am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? Now how do you think they thought in their mind when they heard that read to them as this letter was read before the congregations? Especially when he's dealing with what they have already embraced as the truth, which was not the gospel he brought to them. The question that we just talked about proves that children of God should be rebuked when needed. If you as parents love your children, you will rebuke them when needed. If you say you love them and you never try to teach and train and correct them, you don't love them. I don't care how you smother them with kisses and all these things. Most of the New Testament was written to instruct, to reprove, to rebuke, and yes, to encourage Christians to continue on in the straight and narrow way of truth. You remember in the book of Acts chapter 8, 18 through 23, here was a young convert, Simon, the former sorcerer, when he saw the power the apostles had, that they could lay hands on people and confer miraculous gifts. That amazed Simon because he was a sorcerer. He'd been a long time making a lot of money fooling people. So he offered Peter money to buy that gift. And you're talking about a rebuke. I can just hear some people saying, well, Peter, he's just been a member of the church for a little while. Don't you think you're a little hard on him? I don't know why people can't read that and come up with that without me telling them. Or some other preacher telling them. Thy money perish with thee. Thou hast not either part nor lot in this matter. That's pretty tough, isn't it? John mentioned the name of Diotrephes and sin committed by him, and we talked about that lately in 3 John 9. Put it in a letter that's been around 2,000 years. Everybody knows Diotrephes. It has a casual understanding of the New Testament. And would you like to be known as a Diotrephes? I mean, think when this happened. Do you think Diotrephes would think that all these years his name would be in the book of God, declaring to him that everything's going to be done my way. It's going to be done my way. If it's not done my way, I will run over you. And that's a real Christian attitude. You can see that taught in 1 Corinthians 13 as to how we think and how we do. Paul said, them that sin rebuke before all that others may fear. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 20 said to a young preacher regarding his responsibility to preach the gospel. I am quite sure, having been a preacher for over 50 years, that on the violation of this passage alone, there'll be a host of preachers sitting to hear the Lord say, depart from me. And probably there'll be a great company of elders going right along with them, because if elders are what the Bible says shepherds are supposed to be, then this has to be done. Well, let's go back and talk about Acts 2.38. We're on agreement on that. Well, I hate to say it, but Acts 2.38 is not in a different book than is 1 Timothy 5.20. It's all in the New Testament. Jesus said, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words. Now, by that you say, I just meant Mark 16.16, Acts 2.38. I didn't mean 1 Timothy 5.20. And that's the way we think, but he didn't mean that. He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. And the question, by the way, very clearly, as we, I hope, have already made clear, means that preaching the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth on whatever topic it is will make you enemies. Make people mad at you. I don't know why people are that way, except they love what they're doing that's contrary to the truth. Well, they love being pointed out that you're wrong. You know, Moses really was trying to be a friend to Pharaoh when he told him the truth. Go back and read it from that perspective sometime. Pharaoh didn't quite take it that way, Exodus 10, 28 and 29. The great prophet Elijah was pursued by the hatred and enmity of wicked Jezebel. Let me tell you something. You get a wicked woman and he'll put a wicked man to shame. She will put a wicked man to shame. It's not by accident that Rudyard Kipling wrote his long poem, "The Female of the Species is More Deadly Than the Male." That, I would say, by sacred declaration and my own personal observation, when you get a bad woman, she'll outdo a bad man any day. So he was pursued by Jezebel. You see, that's the reason you name all your darling little girls Jezebel. When we used to have mules, we named them Jezebel, but we didn't really name our children that. And she was against him for one reason and one reason only. He was a stalwart defender of the truth, 1 Kings 18, 17, all the way through chapter 19, verse 3. Herod and Herodias despised the truth. So much so that John the Baptist preaching the truth unapologetically lost his head because of them, Matthew 14, 1 through 12. The only reason a lot of people haven't killed people that presented the truth to them is that they didn't have the power to do so and get by with it. The enemies of Christ so feared the truth of his resurrection that they actually bribed the soldiers who guarded the tomb to lie about it. Matthew 28, 11 through 15. They'd fit right in Washington or by any state house or human government. Our Lord, knowing this was going to happen, and choosing his apostles, the ambassadors of the court of heaven, to do the work he called them to do when he would go back to heaven, and they were baptized in the Holy Spirit, endowing them with the power to do miracles that would prove that what they spake was from God, not man, warned them that if they would do to Christ what they did to him, then they would have to undergo the same thing. Matthew 10, 22, "And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake." You remember what Ahab, the marvelous husband of Jezebel, had to say about the faithful prophet Micaiah? "I hate him." I'll say at least he was honest about his attitude and what he thought about Micaiah. And here's why he hated him. "For he doth not prophesy good concerning me, but evil." 1 Kings 22, 18. And there's something else in this. You can see how a man like Ahab, as wicked as he was, viewed what was evil. Evil was when you tell me that is sin before God, and yet that's what I want to do. So that's how he determined what was evil. Good is saying anything I want to do, you say that's great. God's behind it. Go to it. God will be with you. And if you read the whole story about him, you'll see that's exactly what it was. You remember when he wanted to buy a parcel of land and the poor man wouldn't sell it? And he went to his couch and turned his face to the wall and pouted. Now you'll see how bad Jezebel was. She reminded him that you're an absolute monarch. Your word is law. What are you doing bawling and turning your face to the wall? Go down there and take the land and forget about him. You can do it. As I said earlier, when women are wicked, they out-wicked men. But that's true of when any of us depart from the role God gave us to do and under the authority of God. Some people today hate gospel preachers. Because I would say this, that a lot of gospel preachers should take the name gospel from before preacher. They're preachers, but they don't preach the whole counsel of God. But those who do get hated for the same reasons we've noticed. The only difference between them and Ahab is that they're not honest enough to admit the real cause of their opposition to God's message. Ahab was honest. He just told exactly why he was what he was. Very few people are honest enough to say, I do not like that preacher because he tells me the truth. I've had some nuts that are worse nuts than others of my brethren say, well, it's not what he says, it's how he says it. Oh, no. It's what he said that gouged them right to the heart and proved them to be contrary to the truth. That's why. People do funny things themselves so they can go to hell when God's trying to place every roadblock possible in the way so they won't go to torment. We just hop over them, go around them, climb over them, tear them down. We're bound and determined to go to hell. By the way, you'll go to hell because you deserve to go to hell and you chose hell. Nobody's going to accidentally stumble into hell any more than anybody's going to accidentally stumble into heaven. We make our plans. Hell's as much a prepared place for prepared people as is heaven a prepared place for prepared people. And this life in the flesh is the only time we've got to prepare to meet our Maker and determine which way we'll go. The cry in every age has been prophesying not unto us right things, speaking to us smooth things, prophesy deceits. Isaiah 30:10, he lived some 750 years before Jesus walked this earth. Men have fought truth for at least two major reasons. Some have been unconscious enemies of the truth. They fought it ignorantly. And no less than Saul of Tarsus falls into that category. He's an outstanding example of this kind of opposition to the truth. And he confessed in Acts 26 and verse 9, I verily thought within myself that I ought to do many things contrary to Jesus of Nazareth. And these things I also did. And then he gives a list of binding disciples, giving his vote against them, putting him into prison. 1 Timothy 1:13, he rehearses that to Timothy. He did it ignorantly and in unbelief, and thus he obtained pardon. He didn't know. Have you ever noticed how quickly he changed from that route of evil to the truth? As soon as he learned the facts of the matter that condemned him, you ever notice what he said? Who art thou, Lord? Jesus says, I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom thou persecutest. And Jesus said, it's hard for you to kick against the pricks. Remember his next words? What wilt thou have me to do? Would to God hearts were that tender today. But those who seek truth will find it, as did Paul. Jesus promised that in Matthew 7:7-8. Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. And he says, everybody that does that, it'll happen. I promise you. And Jesus keeps his promises. Those are present tense verbs in the Greek. That means you never stop asking, you never stop knocking, etc. Because you're in pursuit of the truth. Others remain blinded by error because they do not love the truth. Paul made that clear in 2 Thessalonians 2:10 through 12. That's why they believe error. They don't love the truth. Well, you know, in our country, when you're taught that truth is whatever you make out of it, how would you ever love the truth? If you're a person like a pilot who says, well, what is truth? Then you don't believe truth is absolute and objective and can be found, and you don't believe the Bible is a static standard of truth. It reads the same for all men. There are others, the second class, who knowingly fought the truth, knowing it was the truth. Our Lord explained this when he said, men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. In other words, they hear the truth, they acknowledge it to be the truth, but it condemns them, and they hate it, John 3:19. Maybe this can harken back to some yesterday. Did you ever turn over a rotten log and see what was under it? that ran around, and do you ever see that when the light hits them where they want to go? They don't like the light. They try their best to get back under that law. A lot of people like that when it comes to the truth. They know it's the truth. They're not even going to argue with you about it, but they hate it. So think of those little creatures that they know what light is. That's the reason they're under the rotten law in the first place. They don't like it. No matter how much truth is fought against, you can't change it ultimately and finally. You can't do away with it. You can't make it go away. William Cullen Bryant, a great poet, wrote this about truth. Truth crushed to earth shall rise again. The eternal years of God are hers. But error, wounded, writhes in pain and dies among his worshipers. On the day of judgment, only the truth that we already have in the New Testament will shine forth. So what are we going to do about these things? Suppose the commander of an army were to say, "Boy, shoot. Shoot, but try not to hit anybody." An elder once said that the trouble here is that our preachers are professional ball players. He winds up on Sunday morning and throws a curve around the whole congregation. As a preacher, I do not mind criticizing other preachers because I've been too long at doing it and trying to do what the New Testament said. I know too many preachers. Too many preachers. And that's one reason the church in the mess it is. Except this. This elder was concerned about the preacher not preaching to the members what they needed. Today the elders go out and hire preachers who will do that. And that's one of his first qualifications. Don't make anybody feel uncomfortable. This reminds me of a story I read about the preacher who would preach on neither heaven nor hell. And everybody said it was because he had friends in both places. And I think sometimes people think that way. For some reason people won't preach the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth. Especially when it may mean their job. I'll close with emphasizing the old thing. Well, don't preach a negative sermon. Think about that statement. Don't preach a negative sermon. You just preached me one. You told me don't. The person who lays down this rule violates his own rule by using a negative. What I've learned about people like this, and I told one on the phone one time this, only he was saying, don't judge. I said, "You don't really believe, don't judge." And he got all huffy about that. And we brought up the negative business too, and he got all huffy about that. I said, "Why did you think of me, and why did you take the time to make this phone call, and what did you tell me? And I want to ask you, was that positive, or were you trying to tell me what not to do?" Long pause. And it's the only time I've ever had somebody say this. He said, "You know, you're right." There are a few who will see the ridiculous and absurdities of binding on others what they dearly love. I said, "You know what your problem is? And it's a problem with a lot of folks. You don't mind being negative. If everybody will be negative toward what you're negative, you're happy about that." And that's really the way it is. It also indicts God, for he didn't follow it. 8 of the 10 commandments are negative. But maybe they haven't read the 10 commandments very much, Exodus 20. The inspired apostle Paul said to Timothy as to what his job was to do as a preacher of the gospel in 2 Timothy 4:2, reprove, rebuke, and exhort. 2 out of the 3 are negative. But I guess he just didn't know what he was talking about. Paul, in giving the works of the flesh, named 17 negatives, Galatians 5:19-21. In naming the fruit of the Spirit, which must be in every faithful child of God, He lists only 9 positive qualities, Galatians 5, 22 and 23. He got something wrong, didn't he? Wasn't he kind of messed up? He who wrote the great chapter on love and the importance of obeying God, loving the truth. And here's something else. The attitude, the state of mind, the way we think, our perspective, which attempts to please the people instead of please God. Or maybe I could say it this way. To please the people rather than save the people from sin. Paul's statement is very, very appropriate and up to date and will be to the end of time. For do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be a servant of Christ. Do you believe that? Or is that just for somebody like me? Standards have been lowered, folks, or removed completely. And you know why? To draw crowds. I'll say this strongly as I've ever said it. As the pulpit goes, so goes the church. And the pulpit goes usually the way the elders want it to go. If you're not a child of God this morning, the only thing that can make you a Christian is the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's all there is. The truth makes you free from sin. The truth is in the Word of God, written on your level of understanding, given to man, provided by God, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Because God loves you, He gave you the truth. And you must face the fact that all of sin comes short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. And the wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23. Jesus said to the Jews, except ye believe that I am He, ye shall die in your sins. Now, you think He loved them when He told them that? That's pretty blunt. I think He did. We must believe in Christ, repent of our sins, confess our faith in Christ, and finish our obedience to the gospel by being immersed in water by the authority of Christ for the remission of our sins. There is no other way. Less than that, you cannot become a Christian. You'll die in your sins. More than that, God does not require. That's what He requires to become a new creature in Christ. As a child of God, if you've sinned and you won't repent of those sins, you can't be saved. So if you're in sin as a member of the church, you need to repent of whatever it is. Confess that sin and all of us pray together for you. If it's a private sin, you pray to God for forgiveness. Now that's the way that's right. Can't be wrong, because that's what this book teaches. And it's God's infallible word. Rightly divided, 2 Timothy 2:15. If you need to obey the gospel, then I urge you at this time to think what I've said. Draw from all the background you have of Bible knowledge. Think even of the sentiments of the song and respond accordingly as God searches your heart with you. So come, please, while together we stand and sing.